Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Hey, listen, I'm going to get down on my knees. I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer. I need it. You need it. So let's do this. Don't come to hear from a man. Don't ever come to church for tradition or for ceremonial ritual. Listen, always, always, always come into this place with your heart prepared to hear the word of God. We've got a brand new series coming out starting this weekend called Why Church. We're going to talk about the importance of gathering together. But one of those is to hear and to get the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to be equipped as full-time ministers to a lost and dying world. So I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher. If you're able to stand, would you join me and let's prepare our hearts to receive and to hear the word of the Lord today. Father, we come before you. And Lord, we're just so grateful for the opportunity to be here in the house of God. Lord, we don't take it for granted. Lord, we don't come into this place to hear from a man or from a woman, Lord, from the old or from the young. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you. And we fully acknowledge that it's Jesus Christ as our senior leader. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your precious Holy Spirit would speak to us, would be our counselor, would be our guidance tonight. Lord, show us as we get into the word of God, Lord, things in our lives that we need to work on and things in our lives of encouragement out of the word of God. Lord, I thank you that as we leave this place, we are equipped to be full-time ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world. Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we ask that you set your hand upon all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers in the body of Christ. So Lord, on this week, midweek service, Lord, we lift up our denominational brothers and sisters, our Catholic and Baptist, Lutheran, Methodist, Episcopalian brothers and sisters, those churches that are around the Inland Empire that are having services tonight and throughout the middle of the week. Lord, we thank you that your hand and your Holy Spirit would be upon them. Lord, we thank you for our local churches, Harvest and Sandals and The Well and The Way. Father, we thank you for The Grove. Lord, we ask that your hand would be upon Ecclesia and Emmanuel Baptist and Victory and Trinity. Lord, we thank you for Crossroads and New Creation. Lord, we thank you for all the churches across the Inland Empire. Lord, thank you that we are all brothers and sisters working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, we thank you. To you be the praise, the glory, and the honor. And, Lord, we say that your kingdom come, and, Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, praise God. I tell you, I'm excited for tonight. It's a good word. Get your Bibles out. If you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Proverbs in the third chapter. Proverbs in the third chapter. Now, I got to give you a little bit of a preacher's backstory because it's fun to have to say this. But, you know, of anybody to make this statement true, did you know that preachers have to practice what they preach? Well, just so happens, I was talking about God on Sunday morning being faithful, and because God is faithful to us, we've got to be faithful to God. So here, I'm teaching on Wednesday night, here we are tonight, and I tell you, all throughout Monday, Tuesday, I knew I was doing Wednesday night, I'm thinking, okay, Lord, as I open up the word of my Bible, Lord, I need some inspiration, Lord. I need a divine message. And Monday rolls around, Tuesday rolls around, Wednesday rolls around. Okay, Lord, I know, oh God, you're faithful. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Wednesday comes. I'm here at the church. All right. Going into meeting after meeting. Okay, it's 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 2:30, 3 o'clock. Oh God, hallelujah, you're faithful. 3:30, I'm starting, okay, I'm trying to look into this. So finally, I'm getting to that point now. I'm thinking, okay, I got to start practicing what I preach. I got to trust that God is faithful. He's got service, because we always say every week, you don't come to hear from men, you come to hear from God. So as I was getting into my word, I says, okay, I'm going to take myself to some of the verses that I know. I'm going to remind myself and focus in. I'm going to feed my faith, is what I said. Because if you were here on Sunday morning, you know that we got to do that. So I open up the Proverbs, one of my favorite, I say this every time I preach, one of my favorite verses of the Bible. Can I just say that all the scriptures are my favorite verses, all right? Proverbs in the third chapter. I opened it up to Proverbs in the third chapter, and I was reading this to just feed my faith. And as I was reading this, Proverbs in the third chapter, such a familiar passage of scripture. Proverbs in the third chapter, verse number 5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding." So I'm sitting there and I'm praying, oh, hallelujah, God, I'm trusting in you. I need a word. I need a message. I need something to teach tonight that would speak to the people. Praise God. Verse number 6, "In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path." Lord, I need a word. Praise God. As I was sitting there, I was looking at this. I read it again. I read it again. Says, man, God is so good. I'm going to trust. I'm not going to lean on my, I'm going to, and I started looking. I said, wait a minute. I got it. And the Holy Spirit, boom, just dropped it right in my soul. I said, God, you're so good, man. I started writing it down, putting it together. I'll tell you what, God is good. Even though preachers, we got to practice what we preach and trust in God. And I'm sweating on a Sunday or a Wednesday afternoon because, listen, there's nothing, you know, people always look at me and they say, Pastor Luke, I don't know how you guys get up in front of people and talk. You know, they say, and I think the fear of public speaking is like the top three fears that people have in the world. And I says, listen, I don't have a problem getting up in front of people and talking. I'm afraid of getting up in front of people and not knowing what to say. So that was like Pastor Luke's number one fear, but God is good. So today we're going to talk about the title of tonight's message, looking at a Proverbs, the third chapter, out of these two verses, some amazing verses, is I want to talk to you tonight about a great life. How many of you guys want to live a great life? If you didn't, raise your hand right after service. You can come on up. We will slap the devil out of you. No, you know, the reality is we all want to live a great life. As a matter of fact, I was going to title this message, A Good Life. And I thought, you know what? Good is good, but I don't want good. I want great. So I was thinking about this, and as I was praying, and I was just getting alone with God. My wife was talking to me. She says, babe, let's talk it out. Let's get some of these ideas. I was like, woman, quiet. I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to God. And so she, okay. So as I was talking with God, he just began to show some things in my life that I need to look at. And I know that you and I are in the same place oftentimes. So things that we need to look at in order to live a great life. Three simple thoughts out of the book of Proverbs, out of this verse. And I love how at the end of this, there's a wonderful promise for you and I. So today, I want to just take a quick look. We're going to go through this fast. How many of you guys enjoy short messages? Hallelujah. Some of you are like, Pastor Luke, I'm not going to be religious like that. I came to church to hear the word of God. Praise God. You're my favorite. Those of you that like long messages, I love you. But today, we're just going to keep it simple. Let's get some things out of the word of God to help equip us, to help strengthen us, to help apply our life so that we can learn and we can live a great life. Because truly, it is God's will, God's desire for us to live a great life. Amen? So today I want to just talk about a great life and three things out of the book of Proverbs, and then we'll finish it up with the promise out of the sixth chapter. Three things that we see right here out of the book of Proverbs that we can apply to our lives. First and foremost, for the first thought for this evening is, number one, we have got to learn to give our trust to God. First and foremost, to live a great life, we have got to give our trust wholly to God. Now, you know there's a difference between trusting and trusting. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Are you like, Pastor Luke, I have no clue what you're talking about. You could say, I trust you, but only with a little bit. As a matter of fact, Pastor Dan had a video about a man who tightroped across Niagara Falls. Do any of you guys remember that video? Hey, and he's did it over and over and over again. He says, how many of you guys believe I could carry somebody in a wheelbarrow? They're like, yeah, who will do it? Not a single person. There is a difference between trusting and trusting. And so you and I have got to learn that we don't just trust God. God, I love you. God, you're great. God, I'll worship you. God, I'll lift you up. God, I'll make you first in my life. But we've got to understand that we have got to wholly put our trust in God. I love how Proverbs says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Not with some of your heart. Not with certain areas of your life. Not with this little part over here and this little part over here. But all of your heart. See, God's desire is for us to put our lives wholly into his hands. My wife and I was thinking about this today. I was chuckling as I was coming up with some thoughts of trust. My wife and I, if you're married or you think you want to get married, this should be mandatory engagement counseling. To rent a sailboat and go out into the middle of a lake not knowing what to do, and if your relationship survives, praise God, you'll make it through. When I came back from college, somebody had donated a Hobie Cat, a catamaran sailboat to the church. They had donated it. They did the research on that. The pastor who was over that different ministry of receiving things did the research. And I saw it there. And what we had at the time was a bus yard. And I went over there. It was all covered in dust. And I said, hey, listen, nobody's buying that thing. Well, I'll buy it. What do you think it's valued? He says, $200. Should have been a red flag right there. You got it. I got $200. I go, I buy it, I take it out to the lake. My wife and I, we go buy a little book on how to sail. Okay, at the time, were we married? We were engaged, huh? We weren't even, see, this is mandatory marriage counseling. So there we're out there at the middle of Lake Paris, and we had suffered through some things. I think one of the first times I ever took it out, I forgot to put the plugs in the boat, in the drain plugs, and so we took it out. By the time we came back into the boat or into the shore, we were wondering, why is this boat so low to the water? We pull it out of the water, there's holes in the back of it. You're supposed to put a plug in there, so it's draining water for 20 minutes. One of the times we went out there, we didn't know what we were doing. A gust of wind came out, and I got inaugurated. Now, when I say inaugurated, if anybody who's ever been sailing, they might understand what I'm saying. I got inaugurated into the sailing world as the wind blew the boom. They call it a boom. You know why they call it a boom? Because it hit me square in the forehead, knocked me flat on my back. My wife's panicking in the middle of the lake. No clue how to get back. We're stuck. Can't get there. I'm laying. She thinks I'm dead. I mean, it was a disaster. So anyways, this boat, Hobie Cats, have a way of sailing. As a matter of fact, I've got a picture of my wife and I on another boat. This boat I had a little bit more trust in, but still. So that's my old boat. I used to call that Liquid Lightning. That was my boat, okay? And that's my wife and I. We're out there, and you can see that it has two pontoons, and one of them comes out of the water. That's the way it's designed to be sailed, is one of those are actually out of the water. Now, in order to counteract the boat tipping over, there's actually a line on that boat that has a little clip, and you actually would wear like a climbing harness called a trapeze harness, and you would clip it into your waist, and you would stand where we are sitting and lean full extension out, and your body weight leaning out would counteract the boat falling over. Well, going back to the previous boat, we were out with some friends, my wife and I and another girl at the church, and we were out there and the trapeze lines and all that, and sure enough, a gust of wind, the same spot that knocked me out, the devil was right there, a gust of wind comes, and the mast falls off the boat into the lake. We are out in the lake with no mast, no sails, no way to go, and luckily this good Samaritan on a jet ski saw the whole thing, comes over to us and tows us into the shore where we pull the boat up to the shore. Do you know that once that mast fell over, Stacy and I never again went on the trapeze? Do you know why? Because we didn't trust it. It fell over. The cable broke. I wasn't about to put my life in the hands of a cable that broke. You see, you can trust something or you can trust something. I took the boat out. We trust to sail it. But oh my goodness, I would never again dream on that boat or the one previous to it of ever going out on that trapeze line. You should have seen the harness. It was rainbow colored because it was from 1970. Okay, there might be a reason why I didn't use it that way too. But see, we've got to learn that we've got to trust God wholly with everything in our lives. Not an inkling of doubt in the back of our mind. Not a question of, is God going to come through? Did God hear my prayers? Is God really there? Does he love me? Am I worth this? We have got to learn to trust in the Lord with all of our hearts. In Isaiah, the 26th chapter, I'll just put this on the overhead for you. In Isaiah, the 26th chapter, it's literally called the Song of Salvation, speaks about God, and it says, and you, speaking of God, will keep him, the person in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts you. Verse number 4 goes on, it says, trust in the Lord forever, for in Yah, the name of God, the Lord is everlasting strength. How many times in our own lives have we said, God, I give this to you. God, this is something that I'm dealing with right now. I will, like the Bible says, cast my care on you because I know you care for me. How many times in our lives have we said, God, I give this to you, but then we continue to worry about it. We continue to think about it. We continue to plan around it. We continue to try to figure out how we can solve it. But rather, we've got to learn to wholly trust in the Lord today. Are you guys with me today? In Jeremiah, if you got your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Jeremiah because we're gonna check out some verses here. In Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, speaking about the trust of the Lord, it gives us an amazing contrast that we'll look at. In Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, verse number 7, I love this because we're talking about a great life. Verse number 7 says, blessed is the man. How many of you want to be blessed in this place? See, living a great life, I would equate to being blessed by God. And so Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, verse number 7 says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. I love this picture that it paints. Verse number 8 goes on and it says, Jeremiah 17, verse number 8, I guess they didn't get that message. Verse number 8, I'll read it to you. You turn your Bible there, it says, he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes. But its leaf will be green, and it will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will it cease from yielding fruit. All because the man trusts in God. You know, there's some rivers out here. Locally, we have some rivers up in the mountains, and it's so interesting. You go by them, and the mountains, we live in the coastal desert, it's called. And so our mountains are arid mountains. They're not, you know, they're not like Washington where you've got the ferns and the vines and the moss growing on trees. It's an arid, it's dry, it's there's not a lot of water. But wherever there's a river, wherever there's a year-round river, you can see alder, you can see birch, you can see all these different types of trees, and they surround the banks of the river because they have a constant supply of water. Even in a year of drought like this year to this, like what we're going through, they are still thriving. Thriving and flourishing because they are planted by the river. Those of us that trust in God, when we give to God our hearts and we say, God, I lay it in your hands. I put the doubt in the back of my mind out of the picture. No longer do I think of that, but now I look at you. Now we are like a tree planted by the side of a river. When drought and hard times come, we are still flourishing in the things of God because we are living a great life. So we're looking at Proverbs in the third chapter, verse 5 through 6. Verse number 5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. This is a really good one. Second thing for living a great life tonight, don't put stock in man's abilities. Don't put stock in man's abilities. You know, oftentimes we think of ourselves as better than we should. Has anybody ever been there? I'll be the first to admit. Pastor Dan, we learned on Friday night that Pastor Dan stares at himself too long in the mirror, according to Pastor Jess. But I will give you a confession that I think pretty much holds true to every man and every woman, is oftentimes we look in the mirror or we look at the things that we've done and we say, hey, that's pretty good. I did a good job. I remember one time I had a table saw, it was 400 pounds, and I had four guys help me lift it in the back of my truck. Well, when I got home, nobody was there. I had to figure out how to do it myself. I did. I looked at my wife and I flexed and I was like, yeah, what's up? What's up? You know, what happens though is we get through life and you know we do. We have strengths. God has given us abilities and God has given us the ability to get through things with what's been given to us, our gifts. But at the same time, we cannot put stock alone in our own abilities to get us through or the abilities of those others around us. As Proverbs tells us in the 5th verse, to not lean not on our own understanding. It's not about how much we know. It's not about how good we are. It's not about how much we trust in ourselves or in those around us, but rather it's about trusting in God and not relying on our own knowledge. We were just there in Jeremiah, the 17th chapter. Conversely, let me take you to the verses preceding what we just read, meaning going before. Jeremiah in the 17th chapter, verse number 5 says, thus says the Lord, cursed is the man. Do you remember how we just read, blessed is the man? Now remember, we're talking about a great life. It says, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. Verse number 6 comes on and it says, for he shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness in a salt land which is not inhibited. These are two contrasts that we clearly see, especially in the season of drought. We see that there are shrubs in the desert, in the sand dunes that grow. Their roots aren't planted firm on the rock like the trees or like those on the riverbed. We see that. So we have a decision. Are we going to trust in God? Or are we going to trust in our own ability or in man's ability or in man's capability to get the job done? And we've got to learn that we don't put stock, we don't put our faith, we don't put our trust in the ability of men, but rather in the ability of God. Sometimes we think that we are stronger than we really are spiritually. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Sometimes, I've seen it over and over again, people, they get saved, they get radically saved, they say, man, I'm going to go right back to where I was. I'm going to go witness to the people that I used to hang around with. And we think that we are stronger spiritually because, oh man, I got this. But all of a sudden, as they hang around those old time influences, they begin to get pulled back in. Why? Because they're getting into the ability, that their own ability to witness rather than to trust in God and to be led by God. Oftentimes, we think that we're stronger than we really are. I remember there was this letter that I had read that had been going around. I believe there is even a song made about it. So I was looking it up today to try to find it so that I can read it to you. And I found this video that some students at Texas A&M University had made for this particular letter. And I wanted to show it to you because I think it's so true to the way we are oftentimes when we trust in ourselves and when we try to get things done based on our own strength. So why don't you draw your attention to the screen and watch this quick little video.
Dear sir, I am writing in response to your request for additional information in Block 3 of the Accident Report Form. I trust the following details will be sufficient. I am a bricklayer by trade. On the day of the accident, I was working alone on the roof of a new 5-story building. When I completed my work, I found I had approximately 500 pounds of bricks left over. Rather than carry the bricks down by hand, I decided to lower them in a barrel by using a pulley. Securing the rope at ground level, I went up to the roof, swung the barrel out, and loaded the bricks into it. Then I went down and untied the rope, holding it tightly to ensure a slow descent of the bricks. You will note in Block 11 of the Accident Report Form that I weigh 135 pounds.
The bricks only weigh 500 pounds, but 135 pounds, then that means 365 pounds.
Due to my surprise at being jerked off the ground so suddenly, I lost my presence of mind and forgot to let go of the rope. Needless to say, I proceeded at a rapid rate up the side of the building. Meanwhile, the barrel proceeded downward. In the vicinity of the third floor, I met the barrel. This explains the fractured skull, minor abrasions, and the broken collarbone, as listed in Section 3 of the Accident Report Form. Slowed only slightly, I continued my rapid ascent, not stopping until I reached the pulley. Fortunately, by this time I had regained my presence of mind. I was able to hold tightly to the rope, in spite of the excruciating pain I was now beginning to experience. At approximately the same time, however, the barrel of bricks hit the ground. Now devoid of the weight of the bricks, the barrel weighed approximately 50 pounds.
Okay, so the barrel weighs 50 pounds now, but I still weigh 135, so the difference is negative.
As you might imagine, I began a rapid descent down the side of the building. In the vicinity of the third floor, I met the barrel coming up. This accounts for the two fractured ankles, broken tooth, and severe lacerations of my legs and lower body. After my encounter with the barrel, I fell onto the pile of bricks. Fortunately, only 3 vertebrae were cracked. I am sorry to report, however, as I lay there on the pile of bricks, in pain, unable to move, I again lost my composure and presence of mind and let go of the rope. I hope this answers your inquiry.
You see, when we try to do things on our own ability, with our own strength, trusting in our own selves to do it, the outcome is not always what we hope it would be, as we saw demonstrated in that little animation short. And so we got to learn that we cannot put our stock in ourselves, and our ability and our talents. God has given each and every one of us talents. God has given each and every one of us gifts, but we cannot use those gifts or those abilities or those talents that God has given to us and believe that that is all we need to get through life, but rather we have got to use those in conjunction with our whole trust in God in order to see us through life and everything that life has to throw at us. So we have got to learn, and I love this, especially after that video, in Proverbs the 28th chapter, I'll just put it up on the overhead. He who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but whoever walks wisely will be delivered. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in life, trying to figure out why God did or did not do something. Sometimes we get so wrapped up that we try to explain, how did this happen? Or why did this happen this way? Or God, where were you in this? And we try to rationalize it. We try to understand things that are not natural to us as human beings. We try to look at the supernatural and define it with our natural capabilities. And what we're simply doing is trying to make it so that instead of going to the level of God and where God is at, we are actually trying to bring God down to our level. We should never, guys, bring God to our level of understanding, but rather rise to the understanding that God has the answers. We may not ever have all the answers to life, but we trust in God who does. Are you guys with me today? We've got to learn to not put stock in man's abilities, to not trust in our own self and in our own abilities. And last one for today, in everything we do, in order to live a great life, in everything we do, do it unto God. Proverbs in the 3rd chapter, verse number 6 says, in all your ways, acknowledge him. In everything that you and I do, we have got to learn to do it unto God. We are walking, talking, mobile billboards for the glory of God. Whether it be at work, whether it be at home, whether it be, oh my Lord, on the road, we should always reflect God's goodness in our lives and to acknowledge God. I tell you what, my biggest pet peeve, you probably share this, is when it's a traffic jam. You know what I'm talking about? When the cars are all stopped and there's that one guy that thinks he's got it figured out, drives on the shoulder, makes his own lane. And you know, they don't ever make eye contact with you. It's like a passive-aggressive driving. And you're there. You've been waiting at the stop sign or at the stoplight 2-3 different times it's going through. It's road construction or something going on like that. Over there on the perpetual construction of the 215, right? And there's that one guy. And they're not looking at you, but they're forcing their way in. And you're like, No. I have been here. I have held my spot. And you know what I'm talking about. Your paint's touching the paint of the guy in front of you, and you kind of looking at each other in the mirror like, I got you. I know this. Just do it, man. We have got to learn in all our ways to acknowledge God. I've never been a finger guy. Praise the Lord. I remember one time as a child, somebody cut off Pastor Deborah right there on Alabama Street in Redlands. I remember vividly. Somebody cut her off. And I said to her, Mom, give him the finger. I was then educated as to what that meant. Therefore, I've never been a finger person. But praise God, you know what? Instead of being finger people, we got to say, hey, you know what, man? Tell you what, the Bible says, who's last shall be first, who's first shall be last. Go on in. God is good. And love people, even when they don't realize it, when they don't recognize it, when they don't accept it, because God loves us. Life is too short for us to get so wrapped up in ourselves, so wrapped up in our world that we can't get out there and love a lost and dying world and to show the love of God all throughout in everything that we do. Are you guys with me today? I know that one's like, man, I don't know about that one. That's kind of like, okay. 1 Chronicles in the 16th chapter says, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deed among the peoples. You got to shout it out. Got to let it go. Whatever we're doing, we are walking, talking billboards for the glory of God. I remember when we moved out to Oklahoma, Tulsa, Oklahoma. We went to Bible college out there. It's so funny. We all ended up working at the same place. There were 5 of us. And all 5 of us got a job at the exact same place. We were all real excited. We all went through orientation together. And, you know, it was a real cool place, a neat environment to work. But I remember as we got to this particular place, it was Sam's Club in Tulsa, Oklahoma, there was a stigma for the people that went to Rhema Bible Training Center that worked at Sam's Club. Every person that we talked to, when we get to talking to them, hey, you know, how did you guys come? Or, you know, they'd ask us, you know, what brought you out here to Tulsa? You know, what you know, you guys are from California. You guys, y'all have accents, is what they tell us. So when we came, oh yeah, well, we're going to Rhema. It was always almost like all across the board, it was the same reaction. Oh, okay. Yeah, we've had a couple of Rhema students work here too. And it was just kind of like, uh-oh. You know, like there was this stigma about it. There were some people that had come, you know, I think, you know, young college students excited for the will of God. They're kind of, you know, flaky on one hand and super spiritual on the other hand. And you put a super spiritual flake in the same, and then you ask them to have responsibility. It just doesn't work out well. You know, it's not that the school was teaching things bad or good. It was just, you know, people were really excited about God and not excited about Sam's Club. And so, but over the course of the 2 years that we were there at college and we worked at Sam's Club, we had to overcome many objections because the people who had gone before us misrepresented who we were and what we stood for. But, you know, praise God, through diligent work, through relationships and through some ups and downs and some ins and outs of work, we were able to develop really neat relationships with some people that really needed to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. There was one man that was a former Rhema student that you would never have been able to tell that he was a Bible college student because he had just kind of gotten into his own thing and been doing his own thing in life and didn't talk like a Bible student or a Christian or act like one. And there was another man that was going through some things in his life and we would just continually love on him. And he always felt like, you know, Christians would judge on the decisions that he's made. And throughout the course of these years, we got to just have a relationship with him and just be ourselves, but do it unto God and realize that we're representing God. Maybe it was because I grew up as a pastor's kid, so mom and dad always told me, hey, everything you do represents us. So my mom would always tell me this. You will always say, yes, sir, no, ma'am. Yes, please, no, thank you. So we grew up realizing that we represent our parents. But now as Christians, we realize that we represent Jesus. And as we developed relationships, I remember it was the night that we left, the night that we had all quit and we were moving back home, all of the Sam's Club group gathered together and we all just got to hang out and spend time together. And a lot of them just said, hey, thanks for just being there. Thanks for talking to us. Thanks for hanging out. Pastor Dan got into touch with one of the guys that was not quite living the way he was supposed to, or he knew he should have been living. And he found out later on that he had got himself back into church and was involved and doing the things that God had called him to do. Because we were walking billboards, we were able to share the love of Jesus Christ. Because we proclaimed the goodness of what God was doing, people were receptive to hear and to see what God has been doing and God would do in our lives. So we got to remember that whatever we do, whether it be in the workplace, listen, there are many people in this place that do not like where you work. That's okay. It's all right to say, I'm not satisfied, I'm not happy with the job I have, but that is no reason to be a flake. That is no reason to skirt off or to have attitude. Maybe you're in a relationship right now, maybe at home, your home life is rough or it's just not the way you want. That's no reason to say, well, they treat me this way, I'll treat them that way again. Rather, we've got to understand, everything we do it unto God, as though we are doing it to God directly, which means however we work, whether we like the job or we don't, we do it to God. What it means at home, whether there's strife or it's paradise when we get home, we go and we spend time with our family as unto God. When we go to church, oh hallelujah, I'm gonna get on my soapbox, and we don't like the praise and worship song, instead of a whatever, we do it unto God. Why? Because we trust in God. We don't trust in ourselves. We don't put stock in man. We don't lean on our own understandings. In everything we do, in all our ways, we acknowledge Him. Colossians in the third chapter says that whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. We don't work to please men. We don't serve to please men. We do it because God is worth it. Are you with me today? And my favorite part, the last part of Proverbs, the third chapter, verse number 6, and He shall direct your paths. I love that. You know, that can literally be translated as God will make your way smooth. That's a pretty cool thought right there. And God will make your way smooth. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways, and He will make your way smooth. God will bless you in your life. So I remember Stacy and I just got back from hiking 6 days in the High Sierra. We hiked 50 miles from point A to point B. We ended up at Mount Whitney, the tallest mountain in the continental United States. And throughout the course of hiking, there was a lot of, we call them switchbacks. They're up and back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. You walk an incredible distance only to cover a small amount of elevation. And I remember as we got through a section of switchbacks and we came down the hill, and it was this flat, meadowy area. It was like paradise. Our legs were burning, our ankles hurt, our backs were hurting from the weight of our backpacks, and all of a sudden we got into this meadowy, flat area, and it's like you didn't even feel the pain anymore. Why? Because the path was no longer windy, it was straight. It was no longer up and down and rocky, it was smooth. And the Bible tells us, promises of God, that when we trust in the Lord with all of our heart, lean not on our own understanding, in all our ways acknowledge Him, God will make our path straight. He will make our way smooth. I love this. Psalms in the 23rd chapter. Psalms chapter verse 23, verse number 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I love this. He makes me lay down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. When I get lost, when I get wrapped up in my way, when I don't want to lay down, I want to keep going, I don't want to take a break, I want to push through, the Bible says He makes me lay down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Verse number 3 comes on and it says, He restores my soul, leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. I love that. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. We've got to learn to trust wholly in God. Lean not on your own understanding. Let's not put stock in the ability of men and our own ability to do things on our own, but rather lean on the wisdom of God and not try to figure out everything that God does or does not do, because God is the one who is in control. And in all our ways, acknowledge Him. We are a walking billboard. Everything we do, let's do it unto God. And in doing so, God will make our paths smooth. The pathway to a great life. Did you guys get something out of that tonight? Praise God. Hey, listen, before we leave, I want to make sure, before we dismiss, that everybody in this place is right with God. Listen, it'd be a travesty for us to gather together and to allow you to leave under the pretense that everybody in this room is okay with God, when the reality is there are people in this place that right now need to get right with God. So I want to ask you a question. The Bible says that we ought to examine ourselves from time to time. So let me ask you a question, and nobody would know the answer to this question except you and God. So answer it in your heart, and answer it honestly tonight. If you were to leave tonight, and your heart were to stop beating, and you were to die, would you go to heaven, or would you go to hell? It's a simple question. You know, nobody's going to know that answer. The person next to you is not going to know that. The person in front of you, the person that you came with, your husband, your wife, nobody's going to know that except you and God. So today, let's examine our hearts. Let's examine our lives. Let me ask you this. What makes you so sure you're going to get into heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you hope so, because you want to, because you think you're going to get to heaven, you're going to get to heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God are you going to find that because you have the most positive outlook on life that you're going to get into heaven for that. God's not going to look down on us and say, man, they wanted it bad enough, I'm going to let them in. It doesn't work that way. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you you were a Christian as a child, that because you go to church, here you are tonight, that because you attend on a regular basis or you come on Christmas, on Easter, or whatever it might be, that you're going to get into heaven? Did you know that God's not after your gold star attendance record of a church attendance? God's after more than that. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you've given yourself the title of Christian, because you say, well, I'm a Christian, means that you're going to get into heaven. You know, because you give yourself the title, because you profess or you claim to be something, doesn't make you that. You know, I could claim to be a Dodger. I could say I'm a member of the Dodgers organization. I can go to Sports Chalet and buy a jersey in the pants and go sit in the dugout, but yet never am I in my life a member of the Dodgers organization. They're going to haul me out of that dugout, lock me up for trespassing. Yet we think that because we give ourselves the title of Christian, that means that that's all we need to do to get into heaven. It's all we need to do to spend eternity with God, but there's more to it than that. We'll talk about that. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you volunteer in church, because you've memorized John 3:16, because you sang in the choir, you carried the pastor's Bible, maybe you were a leader in the church. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you did those things, because you served in the youth or children's ministry, you're going to get into heaven? You can't get to heaven because you volunteer in church, or because you're active or you've memorized Scripture. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that. Oftentimes we think that, well, all you have to do is be a good person. Good people go to heaven. I've never robbed a 7-Eleven. I've never done, you know, terrible things in my life. I do more good in my life than I do bad. Doesn't that mean I'm going to get into heaven? Good people go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, you're going to get into heaven? But the Bible does tell us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. You see, God's standard for entrance into heaven is perfection. But we have a problem. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That means each and every one of us have fallen short of God's standard of perfection. So then how do we get into heaven? Simply put, it's like this. It's God's heaven. It's God's way. The only way we can get there is God's way. Can't get there your way, some well-meaning church committee or author's way. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus Christ. Jesus says this. He says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do this any other way but God's way. Jesus, in the book of John, in the third chapter, was having a discussion with a man. His name was Nicodemus. Nicodemus, the Bible tells us, was a Pharisee, a leader of the Jews, an educated man, a dedicated man to the Scripture. Nicodemus taught in the synagogue or the church of his day. Nicodemus gave to the poor, did all the right things, said all the right things. And as Jesus and Nicodemus are having the discussion of eternal life, you would think Jesus would pat him on the back and say, man, you just keep on going, dude. But Jesus says this to Nicodemus, in order to inherit eternal life, you must be born again. There it is. God's way right there. You see, Hollywood, society, culture has made born again to be out to be crazy, weirdo, out of control Christianity. But listen, it doesn't matter what Hollywood thinks. It doesn't matter what society or culture has made that term to be. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing in the eyes of God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Born again simply means this. You've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's not about your mental ascent or your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. You already know who Jesus is. That's why you're here tonight. Did you know that the Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know who Jesus is and believe, yet they're not on their way to heaven? You see, it's more than just your carnal knowledge or mental ascent of who God is. It's about giving God all of your heart. It's about giving God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. Let me prove it to you. The last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus Christ is speaking to the church. When he speaks to the church, he says these words. He says, I'm coming back. And he says, I'm coming back, and when I come back, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. And he goes on and he says, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Wow. Shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus Christ. And what Jesus Christ is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all and will be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does lukewarm mean in terms of your relationship? Let's discuss that. Let's define that. Simply put, lukewarm is you're not all in, you're not all out. You're a little bit up, a little bit down, a little bit in, a little bit out. Occasional church attendance, doing some of God's thing, doing some of the world's thing, kind of riding the fence in and out, not wholehearted for God, not wholehearted against God. If that's you, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough to tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. God forgive us in the American church that we've watered the message down for hundreds of years, that we think that all we need to do is sit in church, all we need to do is attend or hear the pastor preach, and that means that we're going to get into heaven. But I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough, and more importantly, I honor God enough to tell you the truth, that you can't get to heaven based on your own devices, can't get to heaven based on ceremonial, traditional ritual. The only way you and I can get to God's heaven is God's way through Jesus Christ. And Jesus says this. He says that if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. He goes on and he says, but if you deny me before men, he says, I will deny you before my Father. Today, I want to give you the opportunity. I want to give you, in just a moment, the opportunity to ensure your place with God in heaven forever and ever, leaving hell behind. And here's what I'm going to do. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. I'm going to smack my hands real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I smack my hands, here's what I want to do. I want to give you the opportunity. What I want you to do is I want you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, hey, Pastor Luke, I want to get saved. Pastor Luke, I want to give Jesus Christ my heart. Pastor Luke, today, I want to make sure that I get into heaven. You see, I'm a man. I'll see it. He says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put your hand right back down. You say, Pastor Luke, I'm not sure I can do that. I don't know if I can face that kind of embarrassment. The people that I came with, they're going to know or they're going to see. Listen, let me encourage you for a moment. Even if you were to be embarrassed because you raised your hand, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm, welcome, and loving place like the church? If you can't acknowledge God here, how on earth do you expect to acknowledge God in the real world? You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. He's already done everything he could to ensure your place in heaven, leaving hell behind, by giving for your and my sins Jesus Christ to die a beaten, bloody mess, to hang naked on a cross for the world to see, to bear our sin and our shame. God's not in the business of condemning men to hell. He's in the business of redeeming men to heaven, but he loved you enough to give you a free choice to accept or reject the gift of salvation. Today, you're smart. You're smart to know that this is the best thing that you can do. So in just a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to clap my hands. If that's you in this place, who should raise your hand if you've never given him your heart? You've never given him your life. In just a moment, if that's you, when I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Who should raise your hand when I count to three in just a moment? If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in youth group or at a Billy Graham or Harvest Crusade, but you never really followed through with it. Listen, don't walk out of this building without making sure your place with God forever. Who should do this tonight? Who should raise your hand? If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, you've been running from God instead of to God, hey, tonight is the night. September 10th, 2014 is your night of salvation. This is your appointment with God. Don't miss the opportunity. Hey, this is a divine appointment you have tonight. You're here by divine appointment. You've had DMV appointments, dentist appointments, doctor's appointments. This is an appointment right now between you and God. It's only between you and God tonight. So today, all across this auditorium, wherever you're at, from the front row to the back row, those of you guys in the family rooms, you hear the sound of my voice, I'm talking to you as well. If you're out on the campus and you hear the sound of my voice walking around, or you're watching online, at home, in the comfort of your home, or on your phone or your mobile device, if that's you in a moment, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, I'm going to count to three, and if that's you, get ready to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. All across this auditorium, I'm going to count. Get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Here we go. Get ready. One. Two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, I see that hand. Two, I see that hand. Three, I see that. Four, I see that hand in the back. Five, six, I see that hand right there. Seven, I see that. Eight, I see that hand back there. Eight wise people. Nine, I see that hand over there. The usher's pointing to the right. I see you over here in the front row, my man. Nine wise people. 10, I see you right there in the back. 10 wise people. Anybody else in the family room? Is that the family room? One, 11 in the family room. 11 wise people. Hey, I didn't embarrass them. I'm not going to embarrass you. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on. This is your moment. This is your time. Stop playing games with God and let's go forward in your relationship with God today. Right here, right now. Anybody else? 11 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? 11 wise people. Well, praise God for 11 wise people. Hallelujah. If you're at home and you know you need to do this, when you minimize the video screen, you'll see a blue button that says, "Know God." You click on that button and follow the prayer, and I'll tell you what, believe with your heart, confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and raised from the dead, you shall be saved. Follow the prompt on that online. For those of you that are in the building tonight, you raise your hand, you don't get saved by raising your hand, you get saved by making Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior or the leader of your life, and we're gonna do that together. So if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, here's what I want you to do. I want you to grab your purse, your sweater, a Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair. If you're in the family rooms, hey, the ushers will come to help you. Grab your stuff, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get in the aisle, come meet me right here at the altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So if that's you, let's all stand together. Please, nobody leave. If you raise your hand or you should have, come on, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, meet me right here, right now.
Jesus, I believe in you.
If that's you, come on, you can come.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe. Jesus, I believe in you.
If that's you, come on, you can come.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live.
Wherever you're at, come on,
you're the reason
you come.
That I breathe. Jesus, I believe.
Well, hey. Praise God. Hey, listen, guys, you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Today is your new birthday. You're going to get born again today, all right? Here's what I'm going to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you, that cool jean jacket right over there? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys right over there. What? I promise nothing weird goes on. I'm as weird as it gets. I showed you that crazy funky video with the skeleton looking dude. Okay? You got through me. You got it. Okay? He's going to take you right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by asking Jesus Christ to be the leader of your life. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some literature. As you walk out of this place, place, you say, man, what do I do? Where do I go? We're going to point you in the right direction. And the last thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back, meet with somebody right here at the church. We call them spiritual personal trainers. They're a friend. Somebody will meet with you right before church. They'll buy you a cup of coffee right over there in our cafe. You don't got to pay any money. They'll buy you the cup of coffee, okay? Sit down with you, or a soda or whatever it might be. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks. Teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.